like, I remember going to my gynecologist for the first time, and the guy showing me with a mirror, like, let me introduce you to your vagina. And I was like, I already know my vagina. He was like, well, not every girl knows their vagina, so I'm introducing.
Hello, it's Eglantina Zingg. You might have heard some things about me, perhaps. And yes, I am all of that and much more. And in my podcast, The Zingg with double G, I will be sharing my views, thoughts, opinions on culture, society, feminism, sex, and all of it. All of that everyone is thinking, but no one dares to talk about. Every Wednesday, I will be offering you a new episode with incredible guests from celebs, friends, big names, authors, artists. And also, since I love talking to myself, will be only me talking my head. The last episode of the season will be exclusively for you guys with my subscribers. So we'll get to chat, I will get to read some of your DMs, play through voice notes, and talk basically of whatever you want. So don't forget to subscribe, join the fun, and listen to The Zingg every Wednesday. You can find The Zingg at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Amazon Music, or wherever you get your podcast. Follow me at Eglantina Zingg, Z-I-N-G-G, to DM and get in touch. Let us explore and lose control.
So guys, let's focus on that moment, on that place of pleasure, because we're going to have an amazing, pleasurable podcast here. Conversation with the one and only Veronica Achon Rengel. Achon?
Achon.
Achon. Achon. Achon. Maybe a little bit French, Veronica Achon. Perhaps we can give a little bit of touch of glamour to her topics, which today I am very, very happy to have a person that I'm very curious to know about this conversation. So welcome, guys, to The Zingg, this new episode. And as per request of all of you in your comments, we're going to talk a little bit about relationships, curiosities, society, culture, taboos, and how to break them, how to shape our own world. We are the architects of our lives. So whatever pleases us and whatever gives us satisfaction, there is no good or bad. Today, we have an expert, a beautiful woman, Veronica Achon Rengel, who is the founder and creative director of Vero.HotinHere. It's getting hot in here, and that's what is going to happen. We're going to get hot in here, The Zingg. And HotinHere is a platform for Hispanic women to discuss sexuality with a dash of levity and a splash of serious, because it's our sex life, and we have to throw out the taboos out the window, because sex is sex. It's something that is natural to every single human being. And Veronica, it's a lawyer with a master's degree in Georgetown University, but she has dedicated her life and her knowledge into giving us all this opportunities to explore our sex life and our sexuality as women in the world, and specifically for Hispanic women. Vero, thank you for being here at The Zingg. Welcome. How are you?
Thank you so much for having me here in your beautiful space. It really is an honor. I am so grateful for the opportunity to be with you. Such a fun, beautiful, smart woman. I immediately feel the connection, and I'm super grateful.
No, come on. And she made us do an exercise right before we started about finding a spot in our, made us breathe, have the little breathing exercise, but finding the spot of pleasure, not the spot of discomfort. So I think that it's a note to start this conversation to wherever you are, take a minute, have a little breath, and have notice and find that spot of comfort within you. So I think when we talk about the subject of sex, there's so many negative connotations around it, about taboos, about judgment. And what we want you to be here right now as an audience, it's to have no judgment, to be open, because it's about being curious. Yes. That you're going to find your own way, your own path, your own ways of finding pleasure, because you deserve it. We all deserve to have our pleasures without being judged or have that sense of guilt. And I think it's a hard topic because, Veronica, how do we start a conversation about sex, around sex? How do you start a conversation around sex being taken serious?
Yes. Well, now that you say that, I just remember this anecdote that whenever I'm in a social setting.
Yeah.
And
you're like, let's talk about sex.
Hello. Hello. Nice to meet you. What do you do?
Why do you invite her here? Who is she?
And the conversation always gets interesting.
And especially women would probably be like, why do you invite her here?
No. And you see people like changing seats and others getting closer. And then some people disclosing things that are like, do we want to say this at this dinner that we just met in front of all these people? So it gets really interesting and beautiful. So it depends on the setting, how that conversation starts. Because if you're at a brunch mm-hmm. with your girlfriends, okay. right? Like that conversation starts from a different point of view.
Yeah.
You know, you can start sharing about the relationship in general and it might get to what's happening in your sex life. If it's within a couple, right? Mm-hmm. People definitely need to talk more about sex. One of the main things, yes, like lack of communication, it's a problem mm-hmm. Between couple, but not talking about sex, it's another one. So there are many ways to start that conversation. Sometimes you even have to schedule it, if it doesn't flow. I am all for going with the flow and vibing, but if you wanna, you deserve to design the sex mm-hmm. life you want. And to be able to do that, you have to put time and attention, just like you put to anything else on your schedule. Is this a priority for me? Let me make it a priority.
But that's interesting because most people, as you say, sometimes in a conversation at a table, it's different, the scenarios,
yes.
but it will attract you or bring you together. Or why would you say, why do I have to bring this subject into this conversation? Perhaps you feel this kind of shyness or this kind of guilt, but the self-knowledge of knowing that sex can be a priority and should be a priority for all of us. It's a healthy way of maintaining a relationship, not only with your partner or different partners, but with yourself. So
unless you're asexual or romantic, which is totally valid, then sex is not a priority in your life. But for the rest of us, that's the case.
And Veronica, she's a graduate lawyer from Georgetown University. She had become a sex coach. So how do we really, how do you come from being a lawyer in Georgetown University to becoming a sex coach?
That's a great story. So here's what happened. I was interested in women, always, and women's issues.
She's a sex animal.
Yeah. No. And that world, with the birth of my children, led me to understanding and wanting to know more about childbirth. So I became a doula and a
yes.
childbirth educator.
Sorry, I forgot that part, the doula.
A doula and a childbirth educator. And during childbirth, sometimes if you had trauma or issues in your sex life, you notice it. You again, by having been to so many births, at some point you see like something is holding the women down or in the prenatal classes.
Mm-hmm.
If you ask the right questions, they may share up something. And then once that lid is open, women start talking more about sex.
Mm.
They feel comfortable with you. They know you might be there in the birth of their child. And you also bring the husbands for a separate class. So that led for women opening up about their sex life, about me being really comfortable with women's bodies. Because sometimes when you're at a home birth, which is something that I love doing too,
mm-hmm.
When you need that uterus to contract, one of the ways of assisting that uterus to contract is nipple stimulation.
Nipples.
Because that makes your uterus contract. So if the husband is busy with the baby, somebody has to stimulate those nipples. So you become comfortable with women's bodies. Also, like when their babies are giving birth, with crowning, with everything. So I became comfortable being in a safe sorority space among naked women in a vulnerable time.
Mm.
So how does that evolve? Those women then, when they had children, or they were like, I catch my child watching porn, what do I do? Who do they call?
Yeah.
Me. So they felt that openness, or they had things with their sex life or something, like if somebody had to have like a C-section or needed a few stitches after birth, which is, you know, a common practice, unfortunately.
And what do you say, unfortunately?
Well, episiotomies are practiced every day in hospitals as a routine, and they don't really need to be a routine. Our bodies are designed to stretch. And even if they stretch and you get a little tear, what happens if you want to tear a towel in two? You cut a piece and you... Yeah. So you do a little... and then women sometimes tear more. So what it's as a regular practice, that does not need to be a regular practice. So anyways, those stitches.
It's good. I had a friend who said, like, I didn't want them to cut because if I cut, then I will never have sexual pleasure anymore.
And you can have sexual pleasure again. And, you know, but you don't need to be cut, and you don't need to have the, you know, the part of healing with dealing with the stitches and all of that. So when women had an episiotomy and they were feeling uncomfortable and they wanted to know, you know, like, back into their sex lives or had perhaps some shame about the ways now their vulvas were looking, like, I was the person that they felt comfortable with, and I loved it, and I loved talking about sex, and I felt comfortable with them too, so I migrated to that, and I love it. I have to say, there's nothing else I'd rather do.
But you started while you were in Georgetown in that college, dorm.
No.
You started talking to your girlfriends about sex, or
you know, there is this is what
how
happens.
Did you start it?
I know. And here's another thing. I guess sex have always been something that I find interesting. I'm curious about, and I enjoy. As a child, I was always asking questions, finding books, wanting to know more. So the people that know me,
give you that book, is like, how do you make papi, mommy? That I was brought in by
a friend showed it to me.
This is how it happens.
Yes. So the people that know me from high school and university, kind of like, oh, you're doing this now. That makes sense. The people that know me from the doula work, mommyhood, all of that, and you know, kids playground, they're like, you're doing what? They know me more for my spiritual practice and other things that I enjoy. So how did that went from Georgetown to that? I think the link was the children, right? After I became a mom, and for the second childbirth, for my second birth, I wanted to become a doula and help other women. Then it went from lawyer to mom to doula to
sex coach.
And yes, I call myself a sex talker, you know.
But you're comfortable. Let's talk about sex. I'm all for it.
And a sex talker.
It's a topic that it's a icebreaker, because when you talk about like sex, people have all sorts of ideas that come into their minds, and they're not necessarily positive. And not everybody feels comfortable in talking about sex, especially about women. Your platform, Vero. It's getting hot in here. It's mainly for Hispanic women.
Yes.
And as a woman and as a Latina myself, I've always find that if you are too comfortable with sex or your sexual life and activities, then you can rather be labeled as a slut. Or if men are mainly more activities or are more familiar or talk about sex, they are praised into this, you know. And through culture and history, you see the phallo as this symbol of power, of something that we praise, and culturally it's something that visually it's pretty, it's beautiful.
Yes.
And not necessarily the bulb of the vagina. Like, I remember going to my gynecologist for the first time, and the guy showing me with a mirror, like, let me introduce you to your vagina. And I was like, I already know my vagina. He was like, well, not every girl knows their vagina, so I'm introducing you to
you. Well, then ask me first.
Vagina? Yes, don't introduce me to something that I already know. I actually have a nickname and everything, but...
don't assume you know what I already know.
No, but there's not much that conversation we have this idea of the vagina, of something that it's a symbol more of shyness or the lack of knowledge that we have, a kind of also shyness, but also with a mix of guilt. Yes. Around, I don't know if it's society, culture, religion in general that brings women into this part of being a sin. If they have the act, it comes maybe from Adam and Eve, the sinner. Yeah. I don't know where it comes from. But why is it the vaginas are also connotated like, you know, that flower that eats the penis and don't put it there because you're going to be this and that thing that smells like sardines. And it's not usually seen as this organ or anatomy of
it's danger.
So like, women, yes. I tend to see women and even in older ages that have not had a good, as you said, as you made us do the exercise, find that zone of comfort or find that zone of pleasure.
Yes.
And I find it very sad.
It is. And, you know, that's why one of the things in my social media is hablando de sexo como si nada. Mm-hmm. Like speaking, you know, about sex casually, like if it was nothing. Not because it was nothing, just not because it is nothing, because it's important and we want to make sure we bring the right attention to it by bringing it to the conversation.
Yeah.
So first things first, vulvas and vaginas. Do you know the difference?
No.
Okay. Great. This is a great starter then, because there might be more than one person that does not know the difference. So the vagina, it's the canal itself. And the vulva is that flower that you're speaking about.
All right.
That, so when you say, you know, the flower, the beautiful flower with the amazing scent, that's the vulva. And it's different from the actual birth canal or the part that goes inside, where you can find G-spots and all of that, but that's the part that it's inside. The vulva, it's the beautiful flower outside. And the clitoris, it's actually a big organ. You know, it has 8,000 nerves ending. It's almost twice as much as the penis, by the way.
What?
And what you see visually, it's only the tip of the iceberg. If you should see how it goes inside and all the spots that it hits, when we call G spot, A spot, and all those spots, that is the same nerve endings of the clit in different parts of your body, inside of your vagina and in different parts of your vulva. So it's really incredible to get to know yourself in that way and experiment that. I have a video about finding your G spot. There, I got a little personal and I kind of share where mine is.
We want to see it. Should we subscribe to your channel or you give us a little a little hint here for the Zingg? But listen, I love the way you're so natural in the way you're speaking about this, because I think when a woman has that opportunity, we grow. It's no taboo that we are in a society that. I find it very interesting and I'm very happy that every moment women are becoming more empowered on themselves. And that doesn't mean that you're taking out any spot or any privilege from men, but you're also getting in a part that you also have an opportunity to feel as a human being of pleasure or of decision, of knowing what you want and you don't want. Usually the act of sex for women used to be just a way of reproduction.
Which is mostly pleasure, not really. It's just for reproduction. The main reason of sex, it's really pleasure. Like how many, like, well, any woman that has tried very hard to get pregnant can tell you this. Yeah. You know, it's not that easy. For some is, but most of the time what it is for pleasure.
So even when they're doing the whole thing to get pregnant, but they don't necessarily have pleasure, or for most of the girl talks that I've
had. It can become challenging. That's a beautiful aspect of how, you know, all the techniques that you use to help a couple that, for example, their sex lives have become a little stale, like a little boring. You can also use for a couple that it's trying to conceive and wants to find new ways of making it interesting.
That becomes a little bit more bonding with them, no? I think,
correct.
You know, and then you have a better connection and they might come easier.
Correct. Yes.
And now you're having a lot of fun trying.
Correct, at the very least.
At least.
It doesn't become a source of stress.
Because I also, the mind, it becomes a source of stress. No?
Yes, it is.
And what about sex with other relationships that are not just heterosexual?
Yeah, what about it? Sex is just having sex with
anything,
gender or like sexual.
Don't tell me you're into animals.
No. Within human beings and in a safe container and environment and with consent within age appropriate individuals. Yes, it's about your orientation. You know, it's about what, and orientation is a concept that keeps expanding because mm-hmm. right now, sexual orientation, it's really related to who do you like to have sex with? And that becomes, that is becoming more expansive. There are more words and things, you know, added to that. And for example, you know, before camera, we were speaking that I'm a sapiosexual, that I'm attracted to people that are smart. That right now it's not considered a sexual orientation, but all those little things, I think, you know, are becoming more and more part of the wholeness of the experience of how each individual expresses their sexuality.
And we're talking about sex and you're a sex coach, but beyond, you're also a woman and you have many broad, as you said, you know, I'm learning. Because that was the beginning of the conversation before cameras. She's like, I don't know everything about sex. I'm just learning for every day. I get couples calling me and I'm learning of different intentions, different interests. And you're just curious about it. And you're like a doctor, you know, you're finding or a scientist or whatever, a coach. But to call yourself a coach, it means that you have all the knowledge.
Correct.
And you were just saying that in a very humble way that every day you're learning. About all these questions, or maybe your clients, or your, how do you say, they're your clients, who has called you with the weirdest thing that you're like, oh, or the thing that you've learned the most? Like,
the thing is, first, I wouldn't want to call it weird, because then that already puts a label or a stigma.
But something that broke your box of like, okay, maybe as a curiosity or maybe opening your channels of
appreciation. I think I can speak of several of them without saying which one are things that generally, you know, can be done in this practice. And you're right. I don't believe in experts. Like, it's almost like we have conversations and we learn from each other and I can guide someone, get the life they want, and I may know a tool or more, but the one that knows what they want and how they want to accomplish, mm-hmm. it's the person themselves.
And usually, what are the traits that a person knows what they want? Because mostly, you know, if you're coming up or your upbringing comes from a society that has all these taboos, how would you know what you want or what you like?
Well, a lot of the times it starts by you, that feeling of wanting more, sort of like when you want to change careers, mm-hmm. you're like, I kind of like this, but there is something more out there for me that I'm missing. Like, it comes from that feeling most of the time, or from something you see mm-hmm. and you're curious about. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, you know, you have explored by yourself, but now you want to explore with someone else. Mm-hmm. And how do I bring this conversation up? Mm-hmm. So for example, one thing that we do is, you know, you can make a list of things that you would want to try, like fantasies, right? Which fantasies are you willing to share? Out of those fantasies, which ones are fantasies of stuff that you don't really want to do? Because they're those, right? Yeah. Like, they're ones that sound really awesome and sexy, but in real life, you don't want to do that.
I like golden showers. Shitting on me is not my thing.
You see? Okay. And then, but then, you know, and then those things that are common ground that you can actually find and try something. What does that become? A threesome that becomes sometimes, listen, it depends on where you're coming from, because doing it out of the bedroom or the bed mm-hmm. and in the kitchen for some, that might be their next step.
Yeah.
And that is okay. You know, changing settings or being watched or exploring using different language. How about, you know, cursing if they've never done that? Yeah. So it depends on where the person it's coming from. And some people want to learn how to be dominated, how to be submissive, or they want to learn, or some women call and they have never had an orgasm. They want to try and see how to experience that. But I am not an expert in their bodies. I do not know what feels good to them. I can help them find out for themselves. That's why I'm not the expert. You're the expert in yourself. You're the expert of what is it that you're longing for. And then we can work together and I can guide you towards that.
But what I think is beautiful is as you call yourself, or you don't call yourself, but a coach, to put it, because you're much more than that. It's to guide them, to give them that support, because sometimes even asking the question, it takes so much guts. Or so much like, am I going
to
ask this
question?
It's to
accompany them,
I would say. Am I being okay? Why am I asking for more? Especially for women. Why am I asking for more? You know, I'm married. I have a family. I have a kid. I have a ceiling. You know, this is my duties. My duties is not to feel pleasure. But then again, then you keep seeing the story of like this unsatisfied woman, men looking for satisfaction somewhere else, and all these troubles in relationship, which I think... sex is something, sexuality is something else. Or for me, you know, your sexuality is so important to your personality. Either you choose to be open, or you choose to be pansexual, or you choose to be sapo.
Some of those are not choices, but yes.
But bueno, all these little titles that we have, yes. And that we want. But at the end, I don't truly believe in labels. I believe on being open, but just how to be open to whatever you explore, whatever your curiosities are, without having being judged or feeling that guilt. And especially for women, because you were going to say something.
Yes, that what you were saying about the different likes and dislikes in sexuality, there is this woman called Diama, which I deeply admire. And she has something that is called the erotic blueprints. And the way they divide that, her and her husband Ian do an amazing work about really being open and helping, you know, people explore this. They say sometimes people are sexual. Sometimes people are more like kinky or romantic or energetic. So the energetics would be, it's interesting because an energetic can feel like the sexual energy across the room. They can almost have an energetic in their full power can have an orgasm without being touched.
Okay.
That's how incredible that is. The sexuals are more genital like people. They're it's more porn, more sexual intercourse for them. Having sex without an orgasm, it's like, what are we doing this for? When that is not really the objective. The objective is pleasure. You don't even have to have an erection. You don't even have to have intercourse or penetration. You can have fun sex in so many ways aside from those. But for sexuals, and that is completely fine, that is how they wanna. That's what gets them on.
Okay.
And then the romantics. And I could say that women are mostly stereotyped as the romantic, and men are mostly stereotyped as the sexual, even though that's not the case necessarily. There are many men that are romantic and then live with this expectation of having to be sexual.
True.
You know, and poor, that's guys, not okay. Or women that are like sexual and then have to, no, you know, I have to wait until I ask, or, you know. And then for romantics, it has to do a lot with preamble. And preamble, like kind of like the sex games,
the pre-game.
Before, yes.
Okay.
The pre-games, previous games to sex that sometimes are even in the house, you know, being nice and kind.
Yeah.
And then, you know, being touchy and feeling. And then for them, they need candles and aromas. And then the kink, they kind of like something forbidden, something stolen, or they enjoy stolen, meaning that doesn't necessarily have to be like, you know, outside of the norm a little bit. And that depends on what to everybody, okay? So that it could be, you know, playing with your brush and experiencing pain, or it could be, you know, being in a dumb submissive situation or experiencing pain in other ways. So all this to say that a lot of these miscommunications also come from knowing yourself, from understanding who you are and what you like. And when you start getting more language, then you can really not only rediscover yourself, but also have a relationship that works because you understand what the other person wants and what you want, and start meeting each other halfway.
I love that. And is there a way of changing and evolving with the years past? Maybe I like something and I want to like something else, and I'm curious about something else.
Absolutely. And there is one last one that mention that it's called a shapeshifter. And a shapeshifter shapeshifts into all of them. which is what I am, and I have said that in videos before. So sometimes you have this, and even though we change, most, you know, people change and can adapt, the shapeshifter, you know, loves all of them and can, and shapeshifts into the, in like, and all of this has its light and all of this has its shadow. A shapeshifter shapeshifts into the partner that they have, which is great, but then you kind of sometimes forget all your other blueprints. See, if you are in a long-term relationship with somebody romantic, maybe the sex, you know, the sex, sexual part of you or the kink part of you are like a little, you know, abandoned, so to speak. So yes. And as you expand and start liking more things and getting into, it's like a palette. It really is like a palette. So there's some foods that you don't like and you may never like. Yeah. And there's some things that you try once.
And it's like, taste.
I could try this again. And then it becomes an acquired taste. So you definitely can change.
And explore and not limit yourself, because you said forbidden. And I feel the word forbidden, you know, what would that be? Forbidden is like, you know, having sex with a married person.
No, or, and I get that, but you do not take away that from the king, because that's their pleasure. You see what I'm saying? I totally get where you're coming from, and I subscribe to that. What is forbidden? But if we make everything allowed, then you're taking the pleasure away.
We want forbidden things.
Exactly.
That's what you get the kick out of it.
Correct. So, you know, it's interesting because, you know, spicy food?
Yeah.
You know, things that are spicy, that's a pain. It's not a flavor. Did you know that?
Yeah.
It's a pain. Not a flavor. So if you like spicy food, you like pain.
I'm guilty as charged. I'm absolutely guilty as charged, but I will disagree with you with the point of spicy food being pain and not being flavor. Because there are spices that are flavor, but flavorful. It is painful.
It is.
And at the end, you end up with lips like this, and even because more exactly. Sexy. But it does turn you on, no? It gives you that heat.
Yes. So for some people experiencing with that, so yes, I agree with you from the point of view that none of that is really like forbidden and what it's wrong and what it's right. But for a kink, they like that sense of, you know, the forbidden, the little painful, the little outside of the norm, in whichever way. That could be something public. Right. Or having like nobody knows that I'm not wearing any underwear things like that. They enjoy like those little disguises. And it could be, you know, an extreme.
Why is it so interesting for somebody not to be wearing underwear?
Right. I don't
because
know.
I can go over the hair ready. I still have pants on.
Correct. Exactly. No big deal. But it's a thing. Right. Everybody's like, woo. So whether it's a thing or not, they want it to be a thing. That's why we can't take it away from them.
If we walk out naked outside in the street, what do you think people would say? Like, oh, crazy. They will come with the cops and arrest us for a public display of affection.
Unless you go to Hall River Beach.
Bueno. And I've been, and it's so it's disappointing.
Really?
Disappointing. I love Hall River Beach. Bueno, last time I was there, it was like about 12 years ago, and I just saw a bunch of sacks. Old sacks, you know, sacks.
Well, part of the things, and I have a video about this, part of the things that I love, it's that I find the beauty in all sorts of bodies of all different ages, looking different, breasts that look different, and people that enjoy their being naked. Some of them, yes, a little more with the intent of sexy, but some of them with the intent of just being themselves. And that's the largest nude beach in the United States. And we have it right
in the
there.
United States.
Yes. And it was like, just to have it there, it took a lot of activism.
I remember, but like in Europe, most of the beaches are
at least topless.
At least topless.
I know.
And nobody's looking at you with a pervert face or anything.
Correct.
And here I think there's so much, also like maybe America, which is such a free country, is so still so conservative at the roots of things. But at the same time, we have the biggest scandals about abuse of teenagers or underage kids and all this repressed expressions of sex, of bringing that curiosity and that exploration into a ground that we can all feel safe and that you are not going to be judged, but you can do whatever you want. But taking it into people that are not consciously right to have these acts, or they have not, as you say, it's consensual.
Absolutely. If you were allow yourself, or society allow yourself to express certain wants and needs in a healthy way, I think there would be a lot less abuse. So I think that's important. And of course, sex always has to be consensual, always have to be a conversation. And it's a conversation not many people have, because it starts from knowing yourself. So self-exploration, right?
First thing.
I always bring this to the step. If you imagine you have a guest from Miami that is coming to visit you here in Miami, and you don't really know the city, and they tell you, okay, take me to a nice places, and you don't really know the city, and you get lost in the turnpike, and all you do is go up and down the turnpike, up and down the turnpike. Are they going to have fun?
No.
Okay, but if you know where the Paris Museum is, if you know the best spots in the beach, if you know the restaurants, the clubs to take them, the interesting place where they do dances, and, you know, the coolest spot in South Point to see the most interesting people on Sunday, are they going to have fun?
Might, yes.
I think so. So if you know your body, and you can tell someone all your avenues,
ride
highways.
Me all my avenues. There's no turnpike here.
Great places.
Fast lane.
You can guide people into your pleasure, and people can have fun, and they can guide you into it. But it comes from self-exploration.
True.
So touching yourself and knowing. And there are ways to deepen that, because it's not just only touching your genitals. You can have orgasms in your neck, in your nipples, in your elbows, you know, there's pleasure everywhere. Your whole skin is a sex organ. Mm. So one suggestion is to start with the senses.
Touch yourself, because I think that's a very interesting point. It's like about women touching themselves. And I bring it back to women, because I guess men, in a way, it's just, you know, jerking off, and it's part
of it. It's more allowed.
Like,
it's okay. That's what they
kids,
do. Boys,
that's what they talk about.
Boys,
it's like whipped cream and blah, blah. But girls don't go and talk like, I just like touch myself and like came and I squirt or blah, blah, blah. I don't like, you know, women actually have orgasms and women squirt.
Yes.
No? Is it called squirting?
It's called squirting. And it's interesting, because now it's like trendy. But before, it used to be a source of shame.
Yeah.
Like a lot of women.
So you're peeing.
A lot of women were like, yes, like peeing. Or imagine, you know, you're having fun sex in the car. And you're like.
Does a woman feel more pleasure when they're squirting?
Not necessarily. You can even squirt without an orgasm. Necessarily. Okay. So sometimes it is that release. So it could be, but it does not necessarily have to be. And it's something that you experience that happened, but to me, it's like every time you have an objective in sex, you're missing part of the fun. Mm. So if your objective is like, we're going to do this until we squirt, you know, to try and make it happen, then like, how about everything else? You know, the same, even if it's penetration, they only, you know, what's fun, you know, telling a couple, okay, you can touch yourselves for this next month, but no penetration. And that builds sexual tension, and they get to explore other parts of their body and other ways of being.
Much more fun.
Yes. And
there's
then you can add
way.
That. And then, of course, you can add that.
And as you say about knowing your body as by yourself, and I think going back to the top subject, women, we're not used to touching ourselves or to talking about, like, you know, how do I feel comfortable and getting to know all my avenues. And nowadays, I think there's I don't want to call it a revolution, but there's much more freedom, and women are having a fantastic moment of finding their getting to know their bodies, their pleasures, what they want, what do they like, what is it that the things they have much more choices. At the end, that also, you know, it's a little bit. A stretcher line to having relationships, but maybe it's a stretcher line to find the right relationship, and even using toys and having that self, which I think there's nothing like having sex in or having a personally, I don't feel that I do feel pressure with masturbation, but I do feel something greater when I'm with a person that I love.
You need that connection.
So
it feels
I feel the connection. It gives you a sense of I know how to touch myself and I will come immediately in a moment or something, or maybe not, but with the togetherness I do feel an enhanced feeling of love or of connection, of sex. I'm not bringing love into the subject, but I think there's a freedom, there's a way of, like, I don't know, toys and this the industry about giving toys, not only for men's pleasure, but for women to have that that opportunity to explore themselves.
Yes, and I one thing that I love and that I always suggest is having a date with yourself. So one day, you think of the senses. You, like, make, let's say, a beautiful corner with pillows and blankets and your favorite music. You can put luscious food, chocolates or things like that, scents, feathers, so chains.
The atmosphere works?
Yes.
Or, like, you can fuck in the bathroom of the nightclub.
You can, but I'm saying this is a plan, a date with yourself to masturbate, to touch yourself, you know, to self-pleasure. And you're having all these things around you that you prepare because you're going to try and play with your senses, the things you see. Beautiful colors, and just focused on the things that you see, and then what you smell, and then things you taste, and you're enhancing your senses. Everything is becoming bigger and broader, and then you touch. But I would use touch as the last one, and try first, you know, the smell, the taste, the touch, and then maybe at the end, yes, you're allowed to touch your their genitals, or you could do one without and one with. But having that experience of expanding and playing with the senses, it's really incredible because we can get desensitized out of amazing things.
Yep.
And becoming more sensible, it's about bringing everything back.
And
to
it's
the
visual, it's the scent, yes. the hearing, and then the touch. But I also like the forbidden part. I think most of my girlfriends, I think the most exciting part that they've ever told me is like the Mile High Club, when they have actually either touched themselves or have had a relationship up in a plane at 38,000 feet. Mm. And they go into a bathroom, shitty bathroom, smells like shit. There's no space, but it's somehow there is been a club for many years about this idea of having sex in an airplane. So maybe it's
in bathrooms, and it's part of the forbidden,
It's probably part of the forbidden.
You're not supposed
to. It's not as planning the date without those beautiful smells and hearing, listening, and all that. But I think it's a great time to be alive, and it's a great time to be a woman. And also, sometimes, don't you think that it has been noted that sex is a tool for power, it's a tool for dominating others, it's that card that you have under the sleeve, either mostly for women, no?
Well, sex
if they
is
use
power.
It right.
You know, sex is power in whichever way you slice it, because just as an energy, sex is really powerful. From Tantra point of view, you can direct your orgasm energy towards your projects, towards the things you love, and fuel with things with that energy. So from the get-go, it's a very powerful, creative force. With a sperm, in one single ejaculation, you could populate a continent. Mm-hmm. That's how powerful that is, you know? So there is power in there. So how is power used? Like everything, you know? You could use power for good, and you could use power for evil. And in our case, yes, we have been deprived to have a free sexual expression without being condemned. Because you have like a big sexual drive that you want to explore.
True.
You know, and from girls too. I noticed and again, you know, treating, having doula clients and their children, it's like, okay, the girlfriend, it's allowed to come to the house for the boy, but for the girl, we're going to treat this differently. Uh-huh. Like, yes. Oh, yes. Your girlfriend can go to your room. No, your boyfriend can't come to the door. Like, this double standard shows in the most basic ways, and we find it even, and I see it between conscious, amazing parents feeling it, you know, because you can't deny it either. It's there, and they feel like, I feel this sense of protection towards daughter that I don't have towards my son, and I am trying to overcome this and give her the chance she deserves. And because she's wearing this or that doesn't mean she's a slut or she's inviting anyone. She's just a way of self-expression.
So why is that?
Well, I think like everything else, it has been culture. It has been like Adam and Eve. Eve did this and this was wrong. Mm-hmm. And women, it's this power that you know, that it's kind of like wants to be caged or controlled or held down. Men are also, you know, very incredibly sexual. So seeing a beautiful woman or a beautiful body, you know, gets them excited. So what, that's dangerous then. That's something that shouldn't be. That's something that, you know, shouldn't happen. Or let's not even get to the porn industry itself, you know. And yes, abusing anything is wrong, but also the industry itself, you know, it's one of the industries where like women led success, director, actresses, they make more money, they
dominate,
correct,
they have their own personality, much more strength within themselves,
correct. So yes, there is, you know, two sides of a coin in everything. And we have now, like you're saying, we're living in great times, and we have the opportunity to help this new generation and ourselves. And not only this generation, because, you know, as I was telling, you know, before we started a recording, I have this thing about the elder. I love, like, and nothing is as taboo about thinking about 80-year-olds having sex.
Why would that be a taboo? I told you, it's like, listen, you know, we're talking about sex, but what happens about your life after menopause, especially for women? But they will say, you know, men, usually the 70-year-old gets to date the 20-year-old. But women, why does your life end after menopause? Do you ever have an orgasm? Would you ever be able to feel sexual?
Absolutely, you can have an orgasm. You still have the same sex organs. Think of this. When a penis is erect, it has the same nerve endings than when it's not. Mm-hmm. So people think that if a penis is not erect, then party over, game over. There's nothing else to do here. It has the same nerve endings. There's still a lot of pleasure and fun in there. But, you know.
For the men.
But I'm speaking, but I'm going there first.
Okay.
Because do you think a man wants to continue to have fun after he lost an erection? No. Okay. They're like, game over. Or, you know, or women. Well, I guess we'll do something else, you know? So that immediately goes there.
Let me touch your little ass.
Correct. Yes, absolutely.
Or
let me touch myself, or let me even just continue to touch you in many other different ways to find pleasure. So what I'm trying to say is that for men, there is a whole world of pleasure without an erection. And for women, if what are the signs that you're experiencing as per the menopause? Would it be less lubrication? Then that's easily fixable. Do you have less libido and do you want more? Mm-hmm. Then that's also hormone balancing or working on your desires, right? But if you do not want more, if you're comfortable where you are, because this is the other thing. Yes, we deserve more and we want more, but that's if we want more. If somebody's comfortable with the sex life they have, to me, how much are you looking forward to the next encounter? Okay. Whether it is next year, next month, or next week. Are you looking forward to that next time that's going to happen? And are you happy with the sex life you have? Then you have no problem. Because otherwise, it's guiding yourself again from the outside norms, but in reverse. Okay. People telling you that you should be having more sex, that what's happening with your sex life, something's wrong with you. And that may not be the case. So for women or men, do they still experience libido, or if they don't, do they want more? If they're not experiencing, are they being told that they, you know, that this does not matter anymore, that this is not the time in their life to be, you know, concerned with these things anymore? You should be doing something else. Is it coming from the outside or from the inside? It's always about self-knowledge and what you really and truly want.
I think it comes from the inside, because we were just speaking also, as I think of, like, of what I've been experiencing, is like sometimes if you go to the doctor, or even the gynecologist, or whatever your doctor is, and they ask you how many times you have sex, and as for a woman, you know, you're ashamed of saying, hey, like, you know, I have once, three times a week. But for a man, if he says once, like, he has to say at least four times or three times a week, even if it's not a true. So I think there's a lot of pressure.
They feel pressure. Yes.
For men of being this macho alphas,
and that is pressure, and that is sad.
The top or the bottom, because you know you have same sex relationships, and everybody can explore. Even in same sex relationships, yes. I have a couple of girlfriends that I asked the other day, who's the top and who's the bottom, and they start having such a fight over who was the top, because it was like, you know, I have the dominant, and I for me, it's like I'm vaca muerta, no? Like, do everything.
Sure, like, yes.
I'm exhausted.
You're a receiver. Some people are givers.
Give me love. Exactly. I don't mind. I don't have that necessity to prove that I am the alpha person. I think in relationships, it's a give. It's an energy that goes circular, no?
Yes, and some whatever people like that. Is. Some people like that, and that is being about being a giver and a receiver, and
a taker.
Yes, a receiver, a taker. Some people, like, when you have two givers together, sometimes that becomes, you know, a tense situation. You know? When you have a giver and a receiver, perfect. When you have two receivers, it can get a little.
I'm gonna give you
a little doll.
You turn around. No, you go down. No,
like, exactly. But it all comes back to having the conversation and knowing each other. You know, I always have this image of in the mirror with lipstick. Let's talk about sex.
You know,
6 p.m. today.
6 p.m., 6 a.m. every day, every morning. But you put a date and talk about sex.
You put a time and a date.
And I think it's very important.
I have to be honest and say that I started this not liking setting dates aside or times aside for it. And then I changed my mind, because if I prioritize the things that are important to me are in my calendar.
Yeah.
Why is this not in my calendar? And does it slip by if it's not with such a busy life? Is it always spontaneous? And here's the kicker. Even when it's not, having a date set aside for this helps you do some planning.
Yeah.
And you can, like, go all Cirque du Soleil if you want, or you can have small planning, but sometimes you don't have the opportunity to do that in the spur of the moment. So if you want to plan, if you want to try different things and you have a time set aside for that, you can bring elements of that. It was like, oh, we're having sex Thursday night. I'm going to go by the sex shop and buy this to try. You know, it gives you that chance too. So
and it works,
beauty.
No? So and you can be spontaneous. Works. You can also plan.
You
and
can
I
do
think
anything.
The planning also works in if you have a whatever kind of relationship you have.
Because, absolutely.
Even with yourself. But we're going to do a plan that every month we're going to meet here with you and we're going to explore more, because I think it's such an important topic, and it's a way of releasing our tension, of getting to know ourselves.
Yes.
And the people that were around, and there's all sorts of relationship, and sex is so varied and in so many different landscapes.
Yes,
that it's a shame that we only have this small vision of finding our pleasure, of giving ourselves the opportunity to feel the pleasure, and of knowing ourselves, because as we were saying, it's about knowing yourself. And sexuality, I think, is a great thing, a great window to know to find your personality. And it helps, because sometimes you see a lot of people that are trapped, and either they have interest in other genders, and they feel trapped because they need to fill the little box of what society tells you of getting married and being bored and making everybody's life miserable. So here is an opportunity to break the norm, to explore yourself without judgment and in a safe zone.
Yeah. And what it's common, it's not only what's available and what's right, you know? So what's the norm? It's not all there is. You know, and we were speaking also about different ways of, you know, of relating. Now, I think I was reading this article the other day recommending people not to sleep in the same bed anymore, to try and sleep in separate bedrooms.
Yeah.
And then when you Listen, it may not be for you, but just considering it right now, I saw that like, huh, okay, that makes sense. You know, building sexual tension, you don't see the person like necessarily naked all the time. And when you see a little bit of something, you're like, I want some of that. Like, yeah. Yes, it can separate, but it could also bring you together. And it's just little things like that, changing perspective.
I think so. I think that's great because we have an idea of what a relationship should be. Mm-hmm. You have to bring me flowers. You have to be this. It's a man and a woman. We don't see men and men. We don't see women and women. Every day we're seeing. We don't see three or mm-hmm. open relationships that you can go with somebody or you can sleep in different bedrooms or you have that space in between that creates that sexual tension, that desire, that respect. And those are a lot of things that I would like to explore. And I think as a conversation, it's great. Listen, you know, even for me, it's like I've dated so many girls that are not considered or have called themselves lesbians. And I don't think you have to put yourself a label. But at the same time, it's also like a Christian guilt or it's an exploration or it's you know, many different source of information that comes.
Exactly. Where like, is it coming from that you
many guys are dating I have been going out with and they will always have this subject of but you like this and then either they're bringing this into the equation.
But does that mean it that I cannot like you as well? Like, yes.
Tell me about your lesbian activities.
Correct. And interesting.
And I was like, that's for me to know and you to find out, motherfucker. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And you know,
and then they get a hard on and it's super incredible. It's super fun. And I was like, now it's finally working.
You see, I love that. And you know, one of the most common male sexual fantasies is having sex with another man, whether they're gay or not.
With another man.
Yes.
By espadita.
See?
Why?
Don't ask me.
Thank
it's
you.
It's just data.
And I think they look beautiful. I love two men porn.
I love it too. But even for cisgender heterosexual men,
this episode
it's a
is going to be rated R. Rated R.
I know.
R. But I think it's an interest. It's a way of breaking a little bit of those standards of society and culture that that as I said, you know. It just brings this guilt and
yes. Allowing yourself to have sexual fantasies.
Have sexual fantasies.
Yes. Yes, because having a sexual fantasy, this is sometimes how I explain this to women. You sometimes, for women that are married with kids and sometimes, you know, are looking for a little more in their sex lives. It's like, okay, do you ever fantasize when you're like fed up with the kids and the things about just heading to the airport and leaving and catching a flight in the first plane anywhere. Have you ever fantasized that? And they're like, well, yes. Okay, are you about to leave your family anytime soon? No. Okay, it's a fantasy.
See?
You're allowed to have it. You're allowed to have fantasies that you do fulfill and you're allowed to have fantasies that you don't. It's okay.
Yeah, I agree. And those fantasies will help you go through your everyday if you're stuck with three kids.
Exactly.
And a husband that is out working.
Correct.
You're allowed to fantasize.
Yes.
Taking that airplane as big as you want at 747. Let's take that flight.
Yes.
Veronica,
yes.
Thank you. Oh, thank no, you for please. Being at the Zing. She's going to be a usual suspect at this podcast because we have
pleasure.
So much more to learn. And these conversations are always so refreshing and helpful. Thank you, Vero. If you want to check Veronica, you can go to her page, Vero.HotinHere.com.
Yes, Vero.HotinHere. TikTok, YouTube, and Instagram. And this is what I do, and I do it because I love it.
And the next one, we're going to explore toys.
Yes.
Shall we?
Yes, by all means.
By all means. We're going to explore toys and then lubes and then, you know, activities for life goes on and sex will always play our music.
Yes, you can also let us know what are you interested in finding out more about sex.
Send your comments. Send your topics. Come on, ladies. Don't be shy.
Yes.
Boys, gentlemen, ladies, and everything around it.
Yeah, you know, my sex channel is for women. But men love to be that fly in the wall, listening to all the things we talk about. So
but
it's
at least they're
curious. It's a great opportunity, yes.
The conversation is open to all of you.
Yes.
Whatever you consider yourself, yes. It's open here because sex unites us all. Yes. Thank you for being at the Zing.
Thank you.
Vero, it's a pleasure. Thank you for listening. And if you find some value in this conversation, don't forget the drills. Share it, love it, subscribe to our YouTube channel, check out Beto's TikTok and all her channels, and stay tuned for more of this incredible conversations and this new season of the Zingg with Double G. Double the fun, double the pain, double the pleasure. Love you guys. Ciao.